A YouTuber called Suspicious Observers has just released a video which turns science on its head, so I thought it would be interesting to take a look. His premise is that we're about to be plunged into a glaciation, based on misreading the conclusions of some scientific studies and his complete misunderstanding of how glaciations start. So let's begin half a minute in where he talks about the Ice Age, part of which is laid out here on his temperature graph.
The ice melts, the planet heats up, the methane is released, and somehow every time we plunge into an ice age.
Just to be clear, an ice age is made up of glacial and interglacial cycles, as shown on the graph. At the end of each cold glaciation, the ice melts and greenhouse gases are released, but we don't enter another glaciation, or an ice age as Suspicious Observer calls it. We get the opposite, an interglacial. That's not just in the textbooks, it's even clear from the reconstruction that Suspicious Observer is showing us.
This is not disputed by anyone.
Actually, it's disputed by every scientific paper that's ever been published over the last 30 years explaining the mechanism of glacial cycles. During the return to interglacial conditions, you can get a temporary step backwards, such as the brief return to glacial conditions during the Younger Dryas period, but the scientific literature clearly shows that when a glaciation ends, the ice melts and we enter an interglacial, as you can again clearly see from the reconstruction.
And for more on this topic, you can investigate the well-understood Milankovitch cycles.
Let's do that. Milankovitch cycles are changes in the Earth's orbit and tilt, sometimes called a wobble. Every 100,000 years or so, these changes cause a little more sunlight to hit part of the Earth, and this melts a little ice and releases greenhouse gases like methane and carbon dioxide. This amplifies the warming and brings us out of the glaciation. The same thing happens in reverse at the end of each glaciation. There's less sunlight, more ice, fewer greenhouse gases, and the Earth is plunged back into a glaciation. In other words, Milankovitch cycles don't do what Suspicious Observers is about to claim they do.
It seems that ice concentrates at the polar region, dropping albedo and heating the planet.
Okay, if ice accumulates, that means there's more ice, which increases albedo. The Earth's albedo is a measure of the amount of radiation it reflects, like sunlight. So once again, this timeline is 180 degrees, the reverse of reality. When ice accumulates at the poles, it doesn't decrease albedo, it increases it. And that reflects more sunlight, which in turn can't possibly warm the planet, it cools it. So this is how peer-reviewed scientific research explains the start of a glaciation. And you're more than welcome to check this with the sources I've listed in the video description or by getting a high school geology textbook from your local library. If you don't want to read anything that hard, simply Google "What causes glacial cycles?" Lots of websites belonging to universities and scientific institutions will explain it. But let's continue from Suspicious Observer's conclusion that more ice warms the planet. I'll block out the top part to make it easier to follow.
This eventually overtakes the polar region as well, melting that ice, releasing the methane, etc. Cold, fresh water and various atmospheric connections send us spiraling into an ice age thereafter.
No, this is completely backwards. When you get higher temperatures as the result of Milankovitch cycles, and that melts ice and warms the poles, that causes lower albedo, more warming, releasing greenhouse gases, and marks the end of a glaciation. The result isn't another glaciation, it's an interglacial. So his timeline is a mixture of two completely opposite processes.
Just this month, we learned that part of that process may include that extra cold fresh water creating a stratification in the oceans that halts convection, not to mention the Gulf Stream.
No, that's not part of the process of glaciation, and the study Suspicious Observer is citing makes no such conclusion.
Both the solar minimum physics at hand and the warming Arctic now present precisely the pattern that makes for the terrible snowstorms like we're seeing in New England this month, the earlier season storms from Europe, the Middle East, and Asia as well.
Well, clearly the tiny drop in solar activity isn't causing these colder winters, and the article Suspicious Observer cites doesn't say that either. That's just something he added himself. Global temperatures have been rising. But it's certainly true that most research has concluded that the warming Arctic and melting Arctic ice are creating a high pressure zone that's sending cold weather further south during the winter. In fact, that was predicted back in 2009, and I reported on it in 2010. And Suspicious Observer cites another study that shows global warming is melting ice in the Arctic Ocean so fast that it could at some point send fresh water south and disrupt the circulation system of the North Atlantic, bringing cooler conditions to Iceland and Northern Europe. But this study, like all the others, doesn't conclude that this will lead to another glaciation or anything like it.
There's a bit of a circular problem here where everyone is finding signals of cold but exclaiming that all the other factors will overcome it to still warm the planet.
Yes, that's why there's a distinction between global warming and climate change. Researchers are indeed finding that some parts of the Earth will get cooler in winter as cold air masses and ocean currents migrate. That's climate change. But researchers say the increasing concentration of carbon dioxide will continue to warm the planet as a whole. That's global warming. YouTubers and bloggers may not like that conclusion, but they have a responsibility not to misreport it simply because they don't like it. If you have a YouTube channel or a blog that thousands of people follow, including my own, you and I have a duty to report the science accurately. You can't pick and mix the bits of science you want to believe and discard the bits you don't like, and then paste your own pet hypothesis on top and claim it's in the papers you're citing.
Now for the whipped cream. Princeton captured the opponent's queen. Cloud cooling effects are underappreciated. They are a net cooling factor, not a net heating factor in the greenhouse sense.
No, the study doesn't say that at all. I've read the Princeton website and the study itself, and neither says that clouds have a net cooling effect. That, again, is a conclusion Suspicious Observers made up himself.
This isn't Venus, and our white clouds have perfect albedo.
Perfect albedo would be 100%, meaning clouds reflect all the radiation they receive. In reality, the albedo of clouds varies between 10% and 90%. And, of course, they also reflect radiation back downwards as well as upwards, and therefore trap heat.
They published two more studies just this year confirming these effects, claiming that it wouldn't be enough to overcome A, B, C, D, and E, not realizing what they were saying either.
Actually, researchers understand perfectly well what they're saying. They're saying quite clearly that even if the cooling effect of clouds has been underestimated, they say that doesn't invalidate climate projections. It doesn't change the fact that clouds also have a warming effect. It doesn't mean clouds have a net cooling effect, and it won't overcome the warming effect of carbon dioxide. In other words, it's not research scientists who don't understand what research scientists are saying, and I'll just leave it at that. I won't spend time going through the rest of Suspicious Observer's video because anyone can do what I just did. Just check the papers he cites and find out what he's misread, misreported, or simply made up. To all those who unquestioningly believe him, it really is as simple as that.